I've been to Calvary. Everybody sing it with us. Come on, saints.
The Calvary Road where Jesus drawn.
Yes, we've been there. Come on.
I saw him hanging there. The Son of.
Close your eyes and raise your hands and sing it with me.
With tear-stained eyes, I knelt to pray. Oh, Jesus, hear.
Boy, that's good singing tonight. Slip up on your feet. Slip on your feet. Everyone, stand on your feet.
I'm glad I've been.
Now lift your hands and close your eyes.
I've been to Calvary. I can say.
Praise him and ask God to move in a supernatural way in this place tonight. Jesus of Nazareth, whom they crucified, but God raised again the third day, and give him power to walk out victoriously over death, grave, and hell. Got the keys to the kingdom of God and said, because I live, you live also. And the works I do, greater works can you do, because I go back to the Father. Clap your hands for victory. Shake somebody's hand next to you and tell them, tonight's my night. Turn your Bibles with me tonight to the 14th chapter of the book of Matthew, the 14th verse. Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. And when it was coming, his disciples came to him saying, this is a desert place and the time is now past. Send the multitude away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves victuals. But Jesus said unto them, they need not depart, give them to eat. And they said unto him, we have here but 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And he said, bring them hither to me. And he commanded the multitude to sit down on the grass, and he took the 5 loaves, 2 fishes, looking up to heaven and blessed and break, and gave the loaves to disciples, and disciples to the multitude. And they did all eat and were filled, and they took up of fragments that remained 12 basketfuls left. 12 baskets full. If you'll notice that next verse, and they that had eaten were about 5,000 men beside the women and children. Now, this is one of the great miracles of the Bible. There's maybe 36 of the miracles recorded, things that Jesus done. All four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, recorded this one. It must have been a real good one for all four Gospels to record it. But I'll back up with you. Matthew and Mark recorded it twice. So that makes six times in the four Gospels that this is recorded. It was real good for Matthew and Mark to record it twice. You can trace this down that this took place. And just stop and think in your mind. Your mind can't comprehend a little lad packing up his lunch one morning and heading out to a desert place. And his mother said, "Where are you going today?" He said, "I'm going where Jesus is." I don't blame him. I'd go where God was. I may have to get out of the place I was in. I may have to leave the church I was at. But I'd go where Jesus was. I'd find me a church preaching the truth. I'd find me a church where he's healing the sick, casting out devils and raising the dead, preaching the gospel. How many believe there's a few of them left? Now this little lad told his mother, "Pack me up a lunch. I'm going where Jesus is." And if you'll take note of this, very careful. There was five loaves or five sandwiches. And over there, the loaves in Israel are not much bigger around than your thumb. Or maybe an inch in diameter. And maybe some of them are 6 or 8 inches long. Never hard to see one a foot long. That's one of the loaves. It's not like a loaf of our bread, a big round loaf. It was small in diameter. Five of them, and one of the writers said two small fishes, not two big ones. Now, we could go further and say, well, maybe a 20 or 25 pound red snapper. But it wasn't so. Two little sardines. And one person could eat all both of them. I've been to Israel. And for breakfast, they feed you those little small fishes about the size of your finger. I mean, what do you want to know? Crystal clear, they're like sardines. How many has ever eaten any sardines? I love them, amen. I love them. I eat them for breakfast. When it was in Israel, they fed them to us. Fed them sardines. But five loaves of bread, about the size of an inch in diameter, maybe 6 or 8 inches long, with only two little sardines. And that's all she had. She packed it up and said, "Son, hurry back." He said, "Mama, I might not be back tonight. I'm going to the meeting where Jesus is." A lot of times your friends will come from other cities or come from afar. And they'll come unprepared to go to church and know that you're a churchgoer. Now, I can't stand that. You know what I'd do, my friends that does that? I say, "Come go to church with us." Well, we didn't come prepared. We didn't come dressed, knowing good and well you were going to church. I say, "Well, I'm sorry. There's a stove and there's a refrigerator. I'm going to church." Let me tell you, there ain't nothing going to stop me from going to the house of God. Clap your hands. I feel some victory. That little boy packed up that lunch, got started out, started down that road, told his mama goodbye. "I'm going to the desert. I'm going to them dry places. I'm going to them hard places. I'm going where Jesus ain't never been. But thank God, Jesus is going in churches where he's never been. Come on, saints, clap your hands for the victory. Thank God the Holy Ghost is getting in churches it's never been. The lames are walking in churches where they've never walked. The preachers are praying the prayer of faith where they've never prayed. But thank God, there's somebody that can still pray. Thank God for preachers that knows how to pray. Thank God for preachers and men of God that's got churches that can cast out devils, heal the sick, or cleanse the lepers, and raise the dead, and preach the gospel unto the poor. Brother, when he got to the meeting there, there was a multitude there. He couldn't get to where Jesus was. Now you go where Jesus is, and you'll find. Haven't you ever been to a church said where two or three gather together and agree in my name? He's in our midst. They're just trying to pacify themselves because they don't have nobody to preach to. Am I telling you people the truth? My God, wake up. Jesus preached to multitudes. Thank God when the sun was setting, they gathered there. They gathered there. Why? Because he healed the sick. He cast out the devils. He raised the dead. He opened the eyes of the blind. He unstopped the ears of the deaf. Oh my God, he was a lame leg healer. He was a blind eye opener. He was a leper cleanser. He was a dead man raiser. He was a gospel preacher. Come on, saints, his name was Jesus. When that little boy got to that multitude there and couldn't see across him, couldn't get to where Jesus was, he kind of reminded me of the little woman with an issue of blood that couldn't get to him. She said, I'll press the crowd. I'm going to get where Jesus is. I'm going to touch him. I mean, I'm going to get something. Honey, when you get desperate enough and you get tired and you get sick of being sick, you're going to find your preacher. You're going to find your church. When that doctor says, there's no more that I can do, honey, you're going to find you somebody that can pray. And you're going to find you somebody that can touch God. You're going to find you a man of God that can pray the prayer of faith that will raise you up. Give the Lord a good clap offering. She got close enough, closer, and got closer to God, closer to Jesus, and touched the border of his garment. She was healed. This little boy pressed the crowd. He pressed it enough, he got acquainted with a lot of the people there. Somebody said, well, listen, it's getting toward dark. How are we going to feed this multitude of people? There's 5,000 men besides the women and children. Now the Bible, neither one of the Gospels, don't bring out on how many women was there. Most men bring their wives, and most of the wives bring 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 children. Why in Israel? It's common for people to have 8, 10, 12, 15 children in Israel. My God, some of them's named John, some of them's named Mark, some of them's Samuel, some Samson. They've all got Bible names. Amen. But they got a bunch of children. Why? There was 5,000 men beside the women. And that little boy, somebody looked over at Philip. Philip, I don't know why Philip, when Philip wasn't that strong in God, said, Philip, what are we going to feed them with? I don't know. My God, he said, we got about 200 pennies. Hallelujah. And we can't feed them on $2. My God, if they'd had $2,000, they couldn't have fed 5,000 men beside the women. But thank God, old Philip said, we don't have but about 200 pennies. How in the world are we going to feed this multitude? What are we going to do? You know what? About that time, somebody looked over to Andrew and said, Andrew, what are we going to do? He said, why, there's a little boy here that's got 5 sandwiches or 5 little loaves of bread and 2 fishes, 2 little sardines. They said, my God, that won't feed this multitude. And about that time, one of them disciples jumped up and said, you don't know my Jesus. All things are possible to him that believeth. My God shall supply your needs according to his riches in glory. Come on, saints. I know what God can do. God can do anything but fail. He said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor their seed of begging bread. My God will supply your needs. Now clap your hands. I feel like preaching. Glory. They said, well, bring that little lad here with them 2 sardines, them 2 little small fishes, and them 5 loaves. He said, law and order comes first. Order comes first with God. If your house is out of order, you can't get a prayer through. You're not going to get a prayer through to God until things get in order. I don't care who you are, what your name is, or how many churches you belong to, how many baptists you've been baptized in, how many preachers' hands you shook. If you are not got your house in order, like God sent Hezekiah word by Isaiah, set your house in order, you're surely going to die and not live. And if that man hadn't set his house in order, he'd have died. You know what he done? He called a check on his record and found a good report. And God said, Isaiah, go back and tell Hezekiah I'm going to give him 15 more years. Honey, if you want an extension on your life, you set your house in order and you get right with God and you get first and you get saved, and then God will heal your body. Clap your hands. I feel the victory. Why, there's people coming up to get healed that's not even saved. Why, God ain't going to give his salvation, give his healing. Healing is a children's bread. Why, that'd be disgraceful to come to God and say, heal me without saving me. My God, Jesus didn't die. He didn't die for your healing. He was wounded for your healing, but he died for your sins and my sins. Did you hear me? My God, he was wounded for my transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement of our peace is upon him, and by his stripes I'm healed. But thank God, without the shedding of the blood, there's no remission for sin. Jesus' blood will blot out your sins and save your soul and put your name in the book of life. Would you praise God? I feel like preaching. He's coming in. He's on fire tonight. Give him a good clap offering. Glory. Don't you just imagine, Hezekiah, set your house in order. You're going to die and not live. And brother, don't you imagine Hezekiah got shook up? How many people are fine coming sometime when the doctors have diagnosed they've got cancer? You know what one of the first things they'll do? They start getting right with God. Some people say, you ought not to tell them. You ought not to tell them. I think you ought to tell them. Thank God, it'll cause them to get saved. If you're not saved, it'll cause you to set your house in order. Let me tell you something. If you've got cancer and you're listening to this preacher preach, they can cut it out. They can burn it out. They can give you treatments. But thank God, I'm going to tell you something. It'll come back someplace else if God don't heal it. But if you'll come, let the man of God pray for it. And the prayer of faith will save the sick. And the Lord will raise them up. Honey, it'll never come back again. I don't care how long you live. Thank God, it's gone. You know why? It's healed. Jesus still healed. Clap your hands for the victory. I love this thought. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and he wept bitterly, cried before the Lord and said, God, I beseech you. I walked upright before you. I've kept your commandments and you know I've lived right. I'm calling a check on my record. Why have I got to die and not live? Honey, if you're living for God, you can call a check on your record. Healing is a children's bread. What the devil will give you any affliction that you will have, he'll put it upon me if I'd have it. He'll put it upon you. He'll pronounce a death sentence on everybody. You can get emphysema in your lungs. My God, you have a heart condition. You can get cancer in your body, or you can turn blind or deaf. But let me tell you something. If you're a child of God and you're saved, it's God's will that you come in and get somebody to lay hands on you. And thank God, when they lay hands on the sick, the Bible said they shall recover. The prayer of faith ain't lost its power. It's just as real as it was when Peter, James, and John went to the gate called Beautiful and looked at that man sitting there. I'm going to preach now. He said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus, the Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. He gave that man his right hand of fellowship. That man stood up, his ankle bones received strength. He leaped and shouted. He praised God. He went up Solomon's porch and got on it. Well, them rich dudes, they went there, but there was that beggar. here sitting at the gate, went out on Solomon's porch praising God. He was dying, no hope. He was laid there daily to beg alms, but thank God he weren't no more a beggar. He weren't no more a bum. He was a child of God. If you're saved tonight, you're not a beggar. Clap your hands. I feel the victory. Brother, I can see his ankle bones receiving strength. They brought me a little girl one night, about 7 years old, and she had on a brace. That brace was warped and twisted about like this, the shape of her leg. Both of the two braces on both legs in a wheelchair. I'll never forget it. And I prayed for her. And I take the little girl home, and instead of her getting better, she got worse. Cried all night long. Cried all night. And about 4 o'clock, the parents called me. The grandparents called me and said, Brother Dobbs, we don't understand it. Says she's cried ever since we've left the church. And said she's cried practically all night. And said no sleep. And something just spoke to me, just like the Spirit of God spoke to me, to tell them people, sit down and pull them braces off of her. Pull them off of her. Hallelujah, because them crooked legs, the Lord had straightened them out, and them braces was hurting her legs. That's what was wrong with her. They pulled them off, and she went to sleep and got up and walked off. Come on, saints. Jesus is real. I said he's real. The power of Jesus is real. My God, let me tell you something tonight. I don't care what your affliction is. I don't care what your disease is. When he come walking the aisles and walking the bill of ways at the fourth watch of the night, he spoke peace to the waters, and there was a great calm. He spoke to the winds, and the winds quit blowing. He talked to the trees. My God, let me tell you something. There's nobody tonight can do what Jesus done. He raised the dead. He preached the gospel. His disciples, he said, the works that I do, a greater works can you do, because I go back unto the Father. Honey, you can't tell me. He told me to lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. He said, if you drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt you. Thank God. He said, I'll give you power to cast out devils, heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, and raise the dead. Are you going to sit there and look at me? My God, this I'm preaching tonight is not from some catalog. It's from God's holy word. I believe it. God said it, and that settles it. Give the Lord a good cup offering. Glory. I was preaching one night, and there was a lady in the rear. I'll never forget it. I'll never forget it. She was sitting back there, and she was on a walker. And she'd been on that walker for 8 years. I mean, just constantly. Just pick it up and set it down, maybe go an inch at a time on a walker. Come in the church like this. Now, I didn't know how long she'd been on it. This is what the children testified later. While I was preaching, just like I'm preaching tonight, preaching his spoken word, your faith will make you whole. The Bible said faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word. When you hear the word, that builds your faith, and your faith makes you whole. I don't care where you're sitting. You can get healed while I'm preaching. I'm not going to lay hands on you. God's word is what does the job. How many of your faith is what makes you whole? You might be listening to me on television. I don't know. You might be in the bed of affliction. You might kick off your braces or kick out the cover and get out the bed and start walking. My God, Jesus never healed nobody sitting down. He always told him when he prayed for him, rise and pick up your bed and walk. Honey, he ain't never healed nobody sitting down. My God, listen to me tonight. When he come to him, he told a man, pause here. I've never seen such greater faith. No, not in Israel. Rise and pick up your bed and walk. He come to the pool of Bethesda and told that man 38 long years, get up. He said, I ain't got nobody to put me in the pool. He said, you ain't got to get in the pool. All you got to do is rise, pick up your bed and walk. That means you can get wheelchairs off of walkers, off of canes, off of crutches. Honey, the word of God will straighten out your crooked legs, open your blind eyes, unstop your deaf ears. The word of God will heal you. Come on and give the Lord another good cap offering. I feel faith. I feel fire. I feel the power of God that'll set his people free. Glory. Glory. God spoke to Moses one time, and he said, go get my people. Go get them. They're in bondage. Let me tell you something tonight, right here in Jacksonville, Florida. If we had to have emergency call and had to evacuate the sick, they had enough ambulances in the south. There's not enough ambulances in the south to evacuate the sick from the hospitals and from the convalescent homes. Just in a case of emergency, we couldn't get them out of here. You know what? God told Moses tonight about midnight, get my people out of here. Honey, there's coming a time when the cry is made at midnight. God's going to tell his prophets, get my people ready. We're going to get out of here. Honey, did you know that the coming of the Lord's at hand? Did you know Jesus is coming back for a church without a spot and without a wrinkle? And one of these wee hours of the morning, old Gabriel's going to pick up that trumpet and swear by him till the heavens be no more and blow that trumpet, and the dead in Christ are going to come rising first. We which are alive and remain shall be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, and caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be together with the Lord. Honey, wake up. This is real. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. He said, the Spirit of God dwell in you, and raise Christ from the dead. It'll quicken your mortal bodies. Don't you tell me it won't shake you. The power of God will shake you. It'll put them bones in place. Old Ezekiel looked at the boneyard. I'm going to preach tonight. Come on, saints. Old Ezekiel's boneyard, it was dry and very dry, but God told old Ezekiel to prophesy. And old Ezekiel, he started prophesying. God, shall these dry bones ever live again? He said, well, prophesy. Honey, you know what I'm doing tonight? I'm prophesying. These old dead bones are going to rise. They're going to live again. We're going to get out of here. Hallelujah. There's a church in a church. Are you with me tonight? Come on and clap your hands. I'm ready to go. Let's go, saints. Clap your hands for the real victory. Shall these bones rise again? Thou knowest, Lord. He said, well, just prophesy. Just start prophesying. Hallelujah. God will cause a wind to blow. You know, on the day of Pentecost, there was a breeze start brewing, a mighty rushing wind. You can't stop the wind from blowing. You can't stop the Holy Ghost from coming in your churches. You can't stop your members from getting the Holy Ghost and the power of God. I don't blame them. If I couldn't get it there, I'd go someplace I could get it. Come on, saints. If I was sick, I'd find somebody that could get me healed. Who can heal you? Jesus is the healer. Come on, saints. All I can do is pray the prayer of faith that'll save the sick, and the Lord will raise you up. All I know, you were sick, but you won't be sick no more. You were crippled, but you won't be crippled no more. I don't understand it, but it works. How many believe it works? Give the Lord a good clap offering. Seek your prophesy. The bones start coming together. God's got an army that's coming together tonight. Did you know the more they fight it, the bigger it gets? It's like a spider's web. You know, it got into the king's palaces. The Bible speaks of the spider's web getting over into the king's palace. I don't care how good the king told a maid to sweep his walls and sweep his house, keep those spider webs out of my house. They get in there just the same. I don't care how rich you are, how many maids you got, how sophisticated you are, how clean you are, them spider webs still gets in your house. Come on. Let me tell you something. I don't care how much you don't like the Holy Ghost, how much you don't believe in speaking with other tongues. Honey, it don't stop it from getting in your family. It don't stop your children from going someplace and getting it. It don't stop your wife from going and getting it. It's real. I said it's real. Come on, saints of God. God's fire is burning and you can't put it out. It's all over the world tonight. Thank God he's coming back for a church without a spot and without a wrinkle. Would you clap your hands? I feel some victory. Why, there was a man that come into the sheriff's office and said they got a meeting going over there under a brush arbor or a big tent. And he said, I want something done. And he said, what you want me to do? He said, well, my wife went over there and got mixed up with them and said she come back the other night after midnight. Said, who in the world ever heard of having church until after midnight? Oh, glory. Honey, they were 10 days and nights in the upper room. And, oh, glory. Hallelujah. And then you get upset if you stay over 45 minutes or stay over 30 minutes when them boys and them men and women that gathered together there and went in the upper room, the supper room, and tarried there for 10 days and nights until the Holy Ghost fell upon them. You know what's wrong with you tonight? You're not tarrying. You're not staying long enough. You're not praying enough. But about that time, Mary, the mother of Jesus, looked at Mary Magdalene, and Mary Magdalene looked at the mother of Jesus and said, what are we doing here? I don't know. I don't know what I'm doing here. And I can see them saying to others, what are we doing here? They said, I don't know. But Jesus said, come here and tarry until we endured with power from on high. Honey, they had to go to the upper room. You ain't got to go there. They wouldn't tarry. You ain't got to wait on it. It's already come. All you got to do is receive the Holy Ghost. Oh, glory. Come on, saints. It's real. You don't get no power until you get the baptism of the Holy Ghost with initial evidence of speaking in other tongues. Acts 1 and 8 said you receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. You shall be witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the world. Now give the Lord a good clap offering. That breeze is blowing tonight all over the world and people are receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That man went to that sheriff and said, can't something be done to stop the meeting? He said, what's wrong? He said, my God. He said, my wife's been going out there for 2 weeks every night, staying late to midnight. And said, last night, he said, they had to bring her in. Told her in the house, bring her in. And said, she couldn't even talk in my language. She was talking in another language. I couldn't even understand my wife. And said the sheriff, looked at him and said, don't feel no bad. Said, night before last, they brought mine in and said, I couldn't understand her. Come on, saints. This thing is getting in the governor's house. It's getting in the sheriff. It's getting in the president's homes. My God, God said, in the last days, I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters, they'll prophesy. Your young men will see visions. And my servants and my handmaidens, in those days, I'll pour out of my spirit. I'll pour out of my spirit. How many feel that God is pouring it out on the white? He's pouring it out on the black. He's pouring it out on the Russians. He's pouring it out on the Chinese. He's pouring it out on the Baptists. He's pouring it out on the Methodists. He's pouring it out on the Nazarenes. He's pouring it out on the Episcopalians. He's pouring it out on the Catholics. My God, God is pouring out his spirit in these last days. There's a ladder rain. Honey, we're living in the greatest time that the world ever knew. Holy Ghost revival. Don't you feel revival? It's in the air. It's on its way. Souls are being saved. The lames are walking and the dumb is talking. And God's cleansing the lepers. He's raising the dead. Come on and clap your hands. I feel the victory. Glory. They start coming in the church. They'll leave here on Sunday night just a shouting and a dancing and praising the Lord and having a ball, having a good time. Come back Wednesday night, and I can see them coming in the door all stooped and say, boy, the devil sure has been after me. I said, I don't see how in the world he could have been after you when I thought he was after me. Come on. Amen. I got news for you. He's not after me. I'm after him. Amen. Every now and then, we're not going the same direction, me and him. We have a head-on collision. And thank God, God give me power to tread over him. That means walk on him. Honey, if you don't walk over that devil, he'll walk over you. If you don't walk over them sicknesses and them afflictions, they'll get in you. He'll kill you just as sure as the world. But God kills and God takes. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Come on, saints. He's a real healer, and his name is Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God, a Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father, Alpha, Omega, the beginning, the ending, the first, the last. He's a sea walker. He's a dead man raiser. He's a gospel preacher. He's a great I Am. He's a bright morning star. His name is Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God. Clap both hands. I feel your victory. I feel some real victory tonight. Clap your hands. Don't you feel it tonight? While my organist comes, I want to pray for a multitude tonight. Thank you, Jesus. In closing, listen to me. He said, sit them down in companies by 50s and by 100s. Glory. I'm not going to heal them one at a time. I'm not going to feed them one at a time. But I'm going to feed the whole house. I'm going to feed the whole neighborhood. I'm going to send revival to that whole area. I'm going to heal and feed 50 at a time. And I'm going to feed 100 at one time. Honey, God can feed 10,000, 10 million just as easy as he can feed 5,000. Come on tonight. Glory. If he filled the widow woman's barrel with oil, hallelujah. Old Elijah prayed the prayer of faith far, and she brought him a whole cake of bread out of there, and she gave that prophet a little bit of what she had. She gave him all she had. Listen to this preacher. That little lad, they said, come to that meeting. Had two little fishes and five loaves. Honey, he gave Jesus everything he had. He didn't have nothing left. He gave it all to Jesus, and Jesus took it and multiplied it. And when he got through, I want you to hear this. If you don't hear nothing else, my God, he took five loaves, that five little loaves, and fed 1,000 off of each loaf. Five loaves, 5,000. He took them fishes, and when they got through, he told them disciples, gather up the fragments. Honey, they were 12 disciples, and them boys got him a basket full of peas. They said, boy, you want some more? He said, no, I can't take no more. I got my basket full. Honey, I got my cup full. The Lord anointed my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Would you clap both hands? My cup's running over, and my baskets are full, and my meal barrels are running over, and my cruses are full of all. Glory.